Okay, everyone, I'm here with Peter from Dopelord. How you doing, Peter?
I'm great. Thank you for having me.
No, thanks for joining me. It's a pleasure to have you on the show. I was just saying to you, I've been really enjoying your new album, Songs for Satan, which is due out. Is it out now or is it due out shortly? I've lost track of time, actually.
It's going to be out on October the 6th.
That's right. Yes. Yeah. There's so many albums coming out at the moment that keeping track of release dates is just really
Yeah.
difficult. And for you, like, do you pay much attention to that when releasing an album? What else is coming out around that time?
Actually, when we planned the release date, we had no idea what other albums will be coming up on that date because many of them just weren't announced yet. So
Yeah.
it's impossible to pick a date that's perfect. So yeah, but just it is what it is, man.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. And so I know some bands are trying to be very careful and try and pick a time of year that they think no one's going to release anything. And but like you say, you can't second guess it, can you? Especially at the moment.
Nope. If you want to pick a date and to be sure that no other band will release an album, I choose the New Year's Eve, I think.
Yeah.
But
Well, funny enough, that was exactly what the lot one of the bands I speak to said. They picked January for exactly that reason, so it would stand alone and not be pecked up by anything else.
yeah.
But this album, it's your fifth album. It's your what, fifth album in just over 10 years now, something like that.
We're gonna hit 13 years in the end of the year. So yeah.
Wow, that's amazing. I mean, did you when you started this band, did you think you'd still be releasing albums 13 years later?
Hell no.
Yeah,
I wasn't suspecting I'm gonna release the first album. So yeah, it was like, yeah, I think sometimes it's just like you start a band and have no plans and see where it gets you. So,
yeah.
yeah.
Yeah. I mean, the reason I asked that particularly of you is because, you know, the music that you guys put out, Stoner Rock and that, wasn't really a thing in Poland when you started the band. So it was a real
No.
gamble in that respect, wasn't it?
Yeah, we were playing for audiences like 10 to 20 people. And we are talking about major Polish town, so like in capital town of Poland, so in Warsaw, it could be like a gig for maybe 50 people, and
Wow.
50 people, and you would know every single last one of them. So, yeah, it wasn't that popular at that time, but it gained popularity like maybe 5 years after that.
Okay. And was that something that you noticed a trickle, like it was growing slowly in the crowds, or did all of a sudden it just seem to explode on the scene over there?
I think there was some point when it really broke, like, and you could actually feel it. In my opinion, when you see like random girls at gigs that are not paying attention to music, just like walking
Yeah.
and like looking around like John Travolta in this GIF. That's the point when the genre is getting big,
Yeah.
because you have many people that are attending gigs not because they're interested in music, but they know that it's a place, like it's a thing that's going on right now. And yeah.
So yeah, jumping on the bandwagon of the scene, yeah, and stuff like that, really. Yeah.
Yep.
One of the good things about that, though, where there's girls, guys follow. So you know that the guys are going to start coming in as well.
Yeah, but I think in metal and in heavy playing, the guys are already there.
Yeah,
Just
very
they're
true.
always first to attend, and they like always in the first row. So yeah.
Yeah. So what made you want to start going down that road of playing stoner rock? If that wasn't a thing in Poland already, what introduced you to the scene?
Yeah, I think that was the main reason, because there were literally no bands playing this kind of music, and we were very into it in that time. And there was, I think, only Beelzebub, and we weren't aware they existed. So, and we are listening to many of those like classical stoner doom bands like Electric Wizard, Sleep, many others. And I think that was the main reason, like we knew there is no such bands and we love this kind of music and we wanted to like give it a try maybe.
Yeah, and it obviously worked because here we are, you know, 13 years later, still talking about it, which is great. This particular album, Songs for Satan, that's come out. I was reading the press release that this is kind of, this album itself is a bit of a reaction against some of the Catholic culture in Poland that is quite persuasive, according to the press release. Is there much behind that?
You know, those press releases are trying to get you. But we are like, it's been with us like our whole lives. It didn't appear before us recording the album, so we are struggling with it like our entire lives. And but yeah, you can say that nowadays it's like maybe even more oppressive because the government and the church are working like together, and yeah, it's never a good thing. So it's a like a huge topic, and I don't want to ruin your evening, so I won't get into the details because there are so many details. And but yeah, the main point is the Catholic Church is something we are totally against. And yeah, if it's if you could see it like listening to our music, yeah, that's our opinion on the matter. So
So I know you don't want to dwell on it too much, but just to get a general feel for, you know, what the story is behind it, is this that they're really still pushing quite a conservative, old-fashioned style of living, and no kind of trying to make everyone conform to the same thing, basically.
Yeah, I think the most important thing they did last couple of years was changing the abortion law. Mm. So it's now something you could go to jail, even if you're like maybe you're a doctor and you're helping some woman that is trying to seek help. Mm. You could go to jail for helping, or maybe someone will tell on you to the authorities and said, yeah, this guy is helping women like getting abortions outside of country.
This is like the kind of the extreme stuff that we're seeing in America as well. Some of those extreme laws that we've been hearing about there. It's crazy, isn't it? That because in Britain we had a case as well recently of somebody go to jail related to abortion, and it's crazy that in the 21st century we're still dealing with that kind of thing, isn't it?
Yeah, man. Yeah, and it really like because they are saying that it's protecting life. It's protecting the innocent that won't fight. Yeah, but they are interested in that life only to the point when it actually gets born. Mm. Afterwards, they don't care. Like, they don't care about disabled people. They don't care about single mothers. They don't care about any of that. So you have to have the child you won't be able to support or whatever. or whatever is the reason you're trying to do what you're trying to do.
Yeah.
But no one will help you afterwards. No one.
So yeah. The album deals with a lot of issues like that then, doesn't it? You know, I mean, I know we use that one as an example, but there's lots of issues that you're kind of talking about on this. Is that something, you know, I'm relatively new to Dopelord. You know, I'm not familiar with the back catalogue extensively. Is this something you've always written about? Have you always tried to pull those issues through?
We don't write like lyrics about your right to like getting abortion. So it's all... Maybe sometimes you could read between the lines, but it's not straightforward. So the lyrics are mostly like I think that on the first albums that they were more into like the usual stuff you would think our band is singing about, like smoking pot and having a good time.
Yeah.
While doing so, and afterward, and like the usual occult themes, and it's still there, but I would say you can like pull more from it nowadays, like the lyrics. We try them to be like more universal.
Yeah.
So. I think any troubled soul would find something appealing in those lyrics, and they are not straightforward. And even though you could get an impression that they are like against oppression or against like I don't know Catholic Church, but they are not straightforward.
Not overt, yeah. So is it more about that, just that feeling of pushing back against something? It's about making that kind of feeling about it.
Yeah.
Yeah. Talk us about the process with the band with this record. You said about you writing, we writing the records. Is it something that the band brings the music, you bring the lyrics? Is it a mixture of the two?
It's a mixture and it's different for every song, but usually me or Pavel, the guitar player, we have some ideas for the riffs, and we are two guys in the band that sing, so most of the times we have like a slight idea regarding the melody. So we try to jam around those ideas in the practice space, and then like while jamming maybe we will come up with some chorus or something. And the lyrics are like, I think 90% of cases are like the last thing we are worried about. Sometimes you have some lyrics and you want to use them.
Yeah.
And you will try to do it. Sometimes you will succeed, sometimes you won't. But yeah, most of the times, first are the riffs and then are the melodies, and the lyrics come in the end.
Yeah, yeah. So trying to craft that around the feeling of the song. I mean, I suppose the feeling that comes from the music, does that then direct the lyrics that come out from that process?
Yeah, sometimes. Yeah, because Pavo has this like ability to sing in this like language that doesn't exist.
Okay.
Like when he tries to... come up with a melody, and we call it in Polish that somebody sings in Norwegian.
Right.
Yeah, because it's the language we don't get at all. So that Norwegian is actually English words, but they don't like have any sense. Like he just gets like, I don't know.
The muse coming through kind of thing. Yeah.
Some people can do it. Some people cannot. I cannot do it. And I just, when I try to come up with a melody, and I have no lyrics, I have to sing like la 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 or whatever. And he sings like, if you won't, like, if you wouldn't be fluent in English, you would think there are some actual lyrics. So yeah, and sometimes from those lyrics Pablo sings, I get some ideas.
Like, yeah.
That was the case with a song from our Children of the Haze album. And there is a song called The Reptile Song. And it was just something he sang,
like,
out of the blue. And I said, what? Reptile Song? I said, why? I don't know. Sometimes
I love that. Really, I love that as an idea, you know, as a process. Yeah. That's really fascinating, because it's like some of the authors from the 50s, you know, that used to just cut up words, throw them in a pile, and then just jumble them around until they started to think of something. It's the kind of oral equivalent of that, really, isn't it?
Yeah, it's a Dadaism.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. And I think, like, whatever works for you. So if we are able to make a song out of it, and if it helps us, we're going to use it.
Yeah, yeah, why not? Absolutely. Yeah. Well, I think it's a great process. It sounds really fascinating. I'd love to be in the room and see that kind of happening. You know, it'd be interesting.
It could be embarrassing too.
With the, utter nonsense just coming out. Just total nonsense. Yeah, man.
Especially for someone that speaks fluent English.
Yeah.
What?
Do you know, I've never asked this question, actually. And I've wondered, for a band like yourself, you know, with English being your second language, do you write in English to start with, or do you write in Polish to start with and then look to try and translate?
No,
that would be completely different.
I never translate. No, I'm not that good. You have to be like a really good translator to be able, and I'm my English isn't perfect, so that would be a struggle. Sometimes I try to do it, but it ended up like translating the like bigger picture. It wasn't like the exact thing I was trying to say, but the atmosphere was there, I hope. Yeah. But it was completely different words.
Yeah. And I suppose you'd have to, because the tempo and everything would be completely different. Yeah. You know?
You have to be very good at translating to make it work.
Yeah. The other thing I wanted to talk to you about with this record was signing with Blues Funeral and it getting the post-wax treatment, because when I first got the email about this record, the album cover just stood out immediately.
Yeah.
It's absolutely beautiful. It's a Martin Donders piece, isn't it, who is well known throughout the scene. How much involvement did you have in that, or was it just handed across to him and said, do your thing?
Martin is one guy. And Peter from Lowrider is the art director in Blues Funeral. So he's the guy that is like holding all the strings and communicating between artists and graphic artists. Mm. And I never spoke to Martin. I only spoke to Peter. And he was asking me about our ideas for the cover, and I told him that usually we don't work that way, because usually we contact some painter or some GFX magician, and we just send him the files so he can listen to the music and he can come up with something like by himself. And of course, our role in this is to pick a guy that we know is going to be right. Mm. So we have to know his work and we have to decide if he's a perfect match or whatever. And usually that worked for us. So when he asked me what is my idea, I told him that my idea is what you have to give the man a record, and I want it to be like as much occult and satanic and like over the top, like inverted crosses, demons, horns, skulls, naked ladies, all that shit. I need it all. Like, if you think it's enough, throw it some more. So and the idea of the, I have the CD because CDs came today.
There we go. Yeah.
And the idea of the of this demon, like, it wasn't looking like that in the first sketch. So I was like, I'm not sure if I know what is going on here. And Peter said, no, it's just the first idea. You have to like pay attention to the details. Maybe something will catch your eye or whatever. And yeah, and the next sketch was like better and better. And at some point it was like, whoa, man. Yeah, it's going to work. So maybe not forced, but we had to trust him. That he knows what he's doing, and Peter was the guy that was like leading us and telling us, yeah man, it's gonna be fine. So
that must be really weird when you normally hand pick the guy that does the work to then hand that over to Peter to choose the right guy.
And post-wax series have two guys now. It's like one cover is done by Martin, and the next cover by another band is going to be made by another guy. Right. And we didn't know at the beginning who's gonna draw the cover. And when Jeff told me it's going to be Martin, I said, Okay, that's nice, because I knew that the most famous, I guess, work for the stoner scene, the Hermit.
Yeah.
Yeah. And that's mind blowing, like over the years. So yeah, I was really hyped. This is going to be our guy. But yeah, it was totally strange for us, because usually we do everything the way we want it. So we had to give away the control, like, yeah. And it was pretty, pretty, like, not comfortable. Oh, yeah.
Yeah. So who got the actual final sign off, Peter or you? As in Peter from, Peter.
Yeah.
Peter get the final sign off, or did he let you have the final sign off?
No. We decided on it. Like, yeah. It wasn't the way the major labels. This is your cover. Yeah. It sucks. Yeah, but it was cheap. No. I had to, like, I as a person speaking on behalf of the band had to okay everything. Yeah. So. Yeah, if anything wouldn't be to our liking, the cover would look differently, I hope.
Yeah, absolutely, yeah. And I think, you know, from what you said about the brief, it does seem to have it all, doesn't it? You know, I mean, I'm looking at it in front of me now while we're talking as well. And you know, the drum with the inverted crosses on the bottom and the pentagram, you've got the ghouls, you've got it all going on there. And every time I look at it, I notice something different on the record, which is what I love about albums, you know, that every time you pick it up, you can discover something new.
Yeah. I love it about it too. Yeah, the details, because when we talked about it with Peter, I told him that he asked me if we want to put some like Easter eggs or some references to the lyrics, on the cover, and there are many, many references to the lyrics, like the nails in the hands,
yeah,
and the worms getting out of the demon's mouth, yeah. So
things like that are really cool as well, because it gives like, you know, real hardcore fans something to listen and pick out and try and work out the connections, which is, you know, that can keep you going for ages, you know, for years. You can keep going on stuff like that.
yeah and I love it.
Have you got a favorite bit from inside of that, because there is so much going on
from the cover?
Yeah Have you got a favorite like little section to it?
Actually, I love the skeleton playing the guitar.
Do you know, that's the bit I'm looking at. That's exactly the bit I've zoomed in on the digital image.
Yeah, but if I had to decide what's my favorite, man, there are many things, like the drum sticks are perfect as well, like banging the drum with little skulls on fire or whatever. And I like those smoky demons, like floating around.
Yeah.
It's like so much going on. And like when you look at some parts, it seems like a simple drawing. Like it's like, yeah. And it's not that simple. So if you look at the whole, yeah, those yellow eyes, man, I love the cover. What can I say?
So much cool stuff. I even like, you know, the bats are skulls as well, you know, and things like that.
Yeah,
all these little details are amazing. Yeah. I'm gonna have to see if we can flash an image of this up on the interview when it goes up on YouTube, so that people can see along as we're talking about it as well and have a look. But if you're watching this and I haven't managed to do that, do go and check out the album cover, you know, have a look back at it while we're talking about this interview, and you'll see some of the bits that me and Peter are talking about here. But Blues Funeral is such a great label for you guys to end up on, and it seems like a perfect matching. How did that relationship come about?
Very, very simple. Judd approached us, like asking if we want to do a post-wax thing. And I believe it was somewhere in the middle of the first edition. And yeah, because I remember, because it was around the time that Elder had their silver and gold EP out on, and it was a tremendous, tremendous album. And yeah, obviously we were interested. We just didn't know if it's something for us, because the first edition was focusing more, I think, on the oddness of the recordings, like the bands doing stuff they wouldn't actually do if it would be their usual album.
Right, yeah.
Like some collaborations and some like Elder doing an instrumental album. And I wasn't into that, and we as a band are no experimenters or we're simple dudes, like
if it's not broke, don't fix it kind of thing.
Yeah, and we are actually doing what we can. It's like we cannot do anything like anything more, sorry. But yeah, I was chatting to Jeff like several times, and yeah, in the end the deal was like really good, and yeah, it became something that we get really excited about doing, and knowing the other bands that are already signed was fucking mind-blowing, man.
It's like a seal of approval having that Blues Funeral, you know, marker on your album. I find, you know, I think it works as that. If people see that, they know it's going to be a good record, whether they fully like it or not. You can trust it's going to be a quality record, I think.
Yeah, I hope so. I hope so. But man, I am still very intimidated by being in such company, like those bands are fucking my fucking idols, man. And yeah, it's really great. So yeah, and Blues Funerals, like, has so many great albums, like many great bands. Yeah, it's, yeah, what can I say,
man? Yeah, so with that, when you finally, you know, when you got that contact from Chad and you know the bands that are on there, and you're like, this is a label with my, you know, did that spur you on to think about it more, or you say you're nervous about it, you almost imposter syndrome, it sounds like, a little bit, did it almost hold you back?
Yeah, it's an imposter syndrome. Yeah, that's the word I was looking for. I think that maybe in the beginning I was like, ooh, what are we going to do? Yeah. But afterwards it was quite a relief, actually, because it was the first album to be released by an actual label. We don't do anything with it. It's not a vinyl release of our CD album done by somebody else or whatever. No, it's the whole thing, being released by an actual label. So it was quite a relief. Like, okay, if it fails, if it's going to be utter shit, man, it's a one-time deal. Like, okay, let's think about it as an experiment.
Yeah,
experiments sometimes end up like in a pile of rubble. So but yeah, I think in the end it went pretty well. So maybe we were like a bit intimidated at first, but it went away.
So I didn't realize that about the previous album. So they were kind of self-produced and pressed, and then you distributed them through somebody else instead of actually having a label.
No, I'm sitting in our distributing center in our HQ.
Oh, wow.
In our HQ, like, filled with IKEA bags and boxes of vinyl and CDs and all that shit, and like the stickers and the patches. I have it all here. So I'm like one man operation in terms of sending out merch and records. And all the previous records we released by ourselves, except for the first one on CD. Yeah, it was released, the first edition was released by some label in Poland. And with vinyl, we got help from this Slovak label, but it was like, it was never like released in the same time. Like,
yeah.
This is the release date. We have vinyl, CD, everything. Nope. And yeah, and afterwards, we were releasing the albums by ourselves, and like two previous ones, are done by us, and yeah, I just became pretty good at it. And I think after sending out thousands of parcels on fucking post office, I'm a post office warlord now. So yeah, the ladies at the post office are rolling out the red carpet when I enter.
Yeah, they see the mountains coming behind you.
Yeah.
I mean, that's even more impressive to be 13 years in and having done that all yourselves the whole way through. That's incredible.
Yeah, but that's mostly because I'm a bit of a control freak, but also like the deals we got from labels that were approaching us over the years weren't that good. I knew after we pressed our own vinyl that, okay, maybe we would gain like more popularity, like more, maybe not audience, but more recognition.
Yeah.
But financially, we would struggle. And I think it's very important for a band that has their rigs of doom and all that shit. You have to afford it.
Yeah.
And we bought pretty much all of our equipment for the money we earned on this band. So
and that's not a position that many bands get to be in, you know, with the band self-financing itself.
Especially in Poland, especially with bands playing such kind of music, I think it's really hard. So we got lucky, and of course it was a lot of work, a lot of fucking visiting post office. But I think it was worth it.
See, I mean, there's a good message there for young bands, isn't there? You know, make sure you think these things through, and it's possible if you're ready to put the work in, willing to put the work in, that you can do it yourself if you give it a try.
I don't know if it's possible right now. It was possible 13 years ago.
Okay. Fair. I suppose with the vinyl pressing backlogs, if you're not with a label, you're not getting to the top of that list, are you, to get your vinyl pressed necessarily?
It's not like that, man. Not like that. That's rubbish. Bands that are lazy are feeding you with. I have no trouble with pressing vinyl.
Yeah,
like, I press vinyl in my hometown. So
okay,
and I was hearing about, yeah, we have to wait 1 year. What? At that time, when bands were saying that they are waiting for years to press vinyl, I was waiting 1 month.
Okay.
So interesting. I don't know. Maybe they like me. I don't know. Maybe I'm a shiny golden god. Yeah. I don't know. But I haven't noticed.
No, okay. So that's interesting. I'm conscious, Peter, that we've got less than a minute left on this call, and Zoom just tends to kick us out. So I'll take the opportunity now to say thanks so much for joining me. It's been a pleasure talking to you.
Yeah.
Hopefully catch up again. If you end up on tour in the UK, we'll have a chat then.
Yeah, man, for sure. Thank you for having me.
Thanks for joining me. Take care. Bye.
Yeah, cheers, man. Bye.